process that's required by the state electoral code. Sorry, were you gesturing to me? Were you asking?
Yes, you want this to go out?
Yes, now we can start the live stream. We can start recording for informational purposes. The first thing that we're going to do is have an overview of the convention nominating process that's stipulated in the state election code for a convention nominating party. And to clarify right from the beginning, this is one of the things that confuses the public, because they go to the polls on primary day and they don't see the Green Party. And they think, that makes them think that we don't exist, but we do. But we fall into a different category under state law. For minor parties, emergent parties, we fall into the category of a convention nominating party. And once a party garners a larger percentage of the vote, between 2% and 20%, they have the option of becoming a primary nominating party and participating in that primary process. And if they have achieved more than 20%, then they have to be a primary nominating party. So that's the first clarification, is why are we a convention nominating party? And the simple reason is because we haven't passed the threshold that's stipulated in the election code. Okay, so now we're gonna go over the process that we have to operate in order to be able to place candidates on the ballot. Here is a timeline. So as we talked about yesterday related to prospective candidates, they file their candidacy with the Texas Ethics Commission and declare themselves to be a candidate. They file with a party to be included on a party's slate of candidates between November, mid-November and mid-December, okay? And then the party notifies the Texas Secretary of State's office at the beginning of the year, January 2nd, to say, hey, we're going to attempt to place a slate of candidates on the ballot, okay? So if that is the course that is pursued. So then the dates for the various conventions are set out in the election code. Second Tuesday is precinct conventions, as usually between 7 and 9 p.m. And so that's March 13th, then the Saturday following is the county conventions, a week later the district conventions, and then the state convention. And at each of those levels, the nominees are confirmed. The voting really happens on the precinct convention date, and we have a ballot for participants to mark their votes related to the candidates. And that's 1 week after the primary elections. So, oh, sure, let's see.
I can help. I'm
sorry. Which one? That one. Nope, wrong one. I'm fired. That little tiny thing. Okay. Better. Oh, isn't that so much better? Yes, it's good. All right, we'll edit that part out. Anyway, so an individual voter cannot vote in the primary and then come vote in our precinct conventions. That would be participating in two parties' processes, and that is illegal and is a... It reflects on the voter. I think, what was it, Kat? Was it like a misdemeanor of some variety? But so that's one of the...
Actually, I think they changed it to a felony.
Yes, Travis.
When are these Republican Democratic primaries that we're supposed to be telling voters who don't participate?
The sixth.
They're 1 week before.
First,
yes.
First Tuesday in March
is primary election. Second Tuesday, convention precinct.
Yes,
we have posted the precinct conventions as consolidated precinct conventions, meaning all the precinct conventions for the county are held in one location. And that's one of the things that we're going to get into in a minute, is that we actually have to operate them as if each precinct is convening separately.
Yeah. We do it order.
Right.
It's not the same as a county convention.
Yeah, it's not the same as a county convention. So, but the most public facing element of them is the precinct convention. And if we're going to get the best start possible, that precinct convention is where we have to really put the bulk of our organization behind.
So when you go over, you're going to follow the county convention and tell them how that would differ?
We're going to go over all the convention requirements. Okay, so, and then after our state convention, we have a little bit more time to get our ballot access petition signatures in line, but then 75 days after the precinct conventions is the ultimate deadline for that. So, let me see. In addition to collection though, and we're gonna go over this in the second part, we're going to have to allow administrative time to compile everything. They have to, of course, be verified, notarized, and actually, I was surprised when I was researching this. A little detail that I found is that, in order to submit a supplemental petition, to be able to submit, which is what the ballot access petition signatures are, we actually have to submit 110% of the verified requirement 10 days before the deadline in order to be able to submit a supplementary petition on the deadline. So, But anyway, so in theoretical terms, with this goal of 47,183 plus 10% minus 10 days, 52,000 on May 19th. Okay, so there's another hidden gotcha in that aspect of it. So at least we already know we're talking about these numbers that are really high, but that's a detail that shouldn't be overlooked and that I was quite surprised about when I was researching.
So you said that if you have a consolidated precinct convention, our petition time is shortened?
No, that has nothing to do with consolidated precinct conventions.
Okay, I guess I'm sorry.
Yeah, no. All I said about consolidated precinct conventions is that we had posted a single location to have all precinct conventions for the county. That's the method that we had been using. And so that's one thing. But this supplemental petition for ballot access, in the rules for submitting a supplemental petition, there's a detail in there that if you're going to submit a supplemental petition on the deadline, you have to submit ahead so they can tell you how far short, so 110%. Anyway, if we need to post and look it up, but this was a detail that was a gotcha, that here I've been preparing all this time, 47,183 for the 1% number, and then reading the instructions, it says, oh, by the way, you have to submit 110% 10 days before.
Okay. Then, all right. No,
okay.
We have
okay. Raquel has a question.
Just give me that date. Yeah.
So at 10 days before the May 29th ultimate deadline is May 19th.
Actually, no. May 27th is the deadline, but it's a holiday. So the permanent date is postponed, so it would be 10 days before that, so it would be
the 17th. Okay, so
May 17th would be dominated for 52,000
rounded up ever so slightly.
But that's not.
It's not, yeah, that's, you know, we could, I guess we could.
Flag on the date, though.
Yeah.
Because we, just in case if something comes up. So my question, I forgot.
Well, you'll think of it again, and then you can ask it.
What is the supplementary petition?
Well, the supplemental petition is the ballot access petition signatures. We are supplementing our convention participants, in theory, with these ballot access signatures, okay? So, you know, if we had that 1% number participate in our conventions, we're good, we don't have to do any ballot access petitioning at all. If we're gonna supplement that, those signatures, we have to, on the deadline, we have to submit what we have ahead of time, which has to be at 110%. So in theory, we could give the whole load on the very last day and you make it or break it, you know, that's it. It better be more than 100%, but it, anyway. So just to show you that the bar, not only is it high, but then there's a little another gotcha there too.
So my question was, when we are collecting these signatures, where are we putting these?
Well, we're gonna need to, they will ultimately need to be returned to the state co-chair so that they can be, yes, that's later. We're gonna go through the actual process for that later, but ultimately they have to be compiled by the state party and sent into the Secretary of State's office. So it's gonna have to come through our organizational apparatus.
Okay.
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 All right, let's continue on just a little bit. I didn't mean to alarm you with that particular item. So this obviously means that for each one of these counties, we need individual human beings, volunteers, to take the responsibility of making these precinct conventions happen. Because, you know, 254 counties in Texas, you guys understand the degree to which we struggle to put on a single event. The state party as a whole can't hold all these separate events at one time. People on the ground in their counties have to hold them. And in fact, you'll see in the instructions that the conventions have to be convened by people who can legitimately vote in them. So
before you move that, so when you say on March 13th, that's the actual convention date, which means solicitation for volunteers needs to go out before this, right?
Yes, in fact, we're about to get into the nuts and bolts of the precinct conventions, but they actually have to be posted more than 10 days in advance,
okay.
So that's got to be all in advance.
Okay.
Is there an hour of the day?
Between 7 and 9 p.m., right?
We should just hold questions.
Yeah, okay, so let's hold
yes.
questions.
Hold
questions.
Yes.
All right, now we're going, if you will, in your packet, it'll probably be a little bit easier for you to follow along a few pages in to the precinct convention FAQ. And, you know, I'm just going to grab one of these pages. So let's go ahead and go through the precinct convention process in FAQ. Now, on the txgreens.org resources page, there is a subpage for convention documents. And we'll, you know, we can take a look at that in a minute, but it actually has quite a number of documents for each step along this process. So we're gonna go through these instructions for the precinct conventions, and it's going to allude to certain forms and whatnot, and those forms are available on off of this resources page that has convention documents. So as we discussed, it's the second Tuesday in March, and no earlier than 7 p.m. and no later than 9 p.m. And there's not a lot, there's not any flexibility. This is the only time for them to be convened. And in fact, this was an issue in Houston in 2016 because we had inclement weather. But nonetheless, that is the time that's set forth in the election code. Before the convention, I think it's pretty clear that in pretty much every county we're going to hold consolidated precinct conventions. But if you were going to hold separate precinct conventions, and I understand in North Texas there may be some reasons based on geography and it being harder to get one place or another, you know, you might want to separate out where the precinct conventions are going to be held. So that, of course, has to be decided, and your location has to be decided. And when you're securing your location, it must be publicly accessible and ADA compliant. So those are two requirements. Then you are required to post notice of the convention time, date, and location on the party's website or the commissioner's court bulletin board if the party does not maintain a website. Obviously, in this day and age, we're able to host sites for the various county parties in this, and you know, we want to work with you to facilitate making sure that all the county parties have a website, so we can make this happen through txgreens.org, but that is the requirement. And then the forms that you'll need. So from that convention documents page, and the link is listed there, you're going to need an attendance list. And for the precinct conventions, you need one for each precinct, okay? Now, Harris County, I think, convened 22 precincts in 2016, but they actually have like 1,054 or something like that. So if we're really, really opening the doors very wide to the public and actually bringing in the number of people that we would hope to be bringing in, thousands, we're gonna need to have some like good planning for how you're going to administrate the people being able to participate and find where to sign in, find how to walk people through the process. So that's something to think about. But you do need a separate attendance list for each precinct. You need affiliation certificates. Wow, somebody's having a party next door. Very exciting. affiliation certificates, and you use the, we're gonna get into the instructions about the affiliation certificates shortly, but that's if somebody doesn't have their voter ID card. Official ballots, which will be provided by the state party. We'll prepare them. A delegate list, so that the precinct conventions can list the delegates that they're sending on to the county convention. Minutes form, and then a copy of the party rules to be available for inspection. Those are for the state party, available on the state party's website. And the form for the convention notice posting, if you're going to put it on that commissioner's court bulletin board. So all of those forms, though, are available on the linked page. So there again, we have a note about the difference between consolidated and individual precinct conventions, but we understand consolidated just means they're all in one place for the county. So to go over what we do at the precinct convention, and so as we said, we need an attendance list for each precinct. So you're going to fill out an attendance list of the qualified participants, and you're going to include their voter registration numbers for each precinct. And then the list needs to be, you sign the list, make a copy, and deliver it to the county chair, who will eventually deliver it to the state chair. You have to provide a numbered ballot for each participant. And what we did in 2016, we prepared the ballots by county, so they were applicable by county. And then regarding which precincts were or were not applicable to particular races, the volunteers administering the convention would, you know, redact a non-applicable race. So that's how we handled making the ballots more specific. So then we, the precinct convention, as we said, also elects delegates to the county convention and lets the voters cast the ballots that have been provided. And basically, our ballot process, the way it's written up in our bylaws, mirrors the primary process in that the balloting is binding to the delegates, except in the eventuality that there were basically no votes cast for the candidate, or that the candidate was like the only person that voted for themselves. So otherwise, the party would have no ability to the party would have a difficult time authorizing its ballot or authorizing its slate of candidates. So, and then finally, decide whether to create and elect a precinct executive committee. So if we were evolving more and growing a lot more in a place like Harris County that has 1,000 precincts, and we were able to start kind of making the organization a little bit more subdivided, maybe, you know, you might have certain precincts or something, but at this point, that's not something that we're probably, that people are probably going to want to do, so that's for future reference. And then, if there are any resolutions that people want to offer through the convention process, they could be accepted then. And then this is also the time to fully engage participants in the ballot access petition process. So obviously the people that are motivated enough to come to our precinct conventions are going to be people who are motivated enough to try to help us with the ballot access petition drive. So of course we want them as fully engaged as is possible. So, getting more specific to the process, we've established that we're operating each precinct convention separately, even though they're in one place. So let's say all the voters from precinct 100, you know, they need to get together and operate their convention as precinct 100, okay? So each temporary precinct chair needs to be one of the following. They either need to have been the precinct chair of the previous convention, or they needed to be appointed by the county chair, or they can just be an eligible participant in the absence of a specifically designated precinct chair. So that just means that a voter, an eligible voter in that precinct, could say, I convene my precinct convention for my precincts, okay? So, you know, if you have 10 voters in that precinct, great. If you have one, that whatever it is, each precinct convention is documented separately. And hopefully, you know, maybe you have 1,000 people in that precinct. Wouldn't that be lovely? So, on admitting a person for participation in the convention, which means, you know, signing in, the temporary chair shall view the voter's photo ID, so that's part of the checking in, administer to the person the following oath. I swear that I have not voted in a primary election or participated in a convention of another party during this voting year. I hereby affiliate myself with the Green Party. After they take the oath, you can stamp or indicate that on that they participated on their voter ID card or on the party affiliation certificate. So if they don't have their voter ID card for you to mark it, then you need to give them the affiliation certificate. So obviously, all of these forms and procedures are going to need to be ready for the volunteers who are operating the conventions. So before conducting business, the temporary chair shall prepare a list containing names, residence address, voter registration number from their card or date of birth, if no card is presented, of each person who is admitted to participate in the convention. So you're gonna, so like we said, all of our precinct convention participants are our first people who count towards that ballot threshold number. So that information needs to be fully complete and correct for it to count. So making sure that we do this paperwork correctly will be very important. So as we indicated, it is actually a criminal offense for an individual voter to vote in the convention if they have voted in the primary, and that is something, of course, that we need to reinforce to them to make sure it doesn't happen. Also, you know, they could be discounted from our count, so there's that too. Okay, so the temporary chair, once everybody has signed in, everybody's found their precinct, they've signed in, the temporary chair shall call the convention to order, select a convention chair, and any other officers considered necessary to conduct the convention's business. which really isn't very many, but you could have a separate person taking the minutes notes. So some flexibility there. And the convention business is to, having already had a temporary chair, elect the precinct convention chair, and then elect delegates to the county convention. So delegates don't necessarily have to be present, but they do need, of course, to be party members. Obviously, you wouldn't nominate people out of the blue. Anyway, attain a consensus on whether to elect a precinct executive committee, and then actually cast the official ballots for candidates. But in simplified form, there's not really a lot of need for officers. It's pretty much the convene the convention, make sure the sign-in, everybody signed in properly and all that information is collected properly, designate another convention chair if another one's going to be elected, and to allow the voters to mark their ballots. So, again, important notes, each precinct has to have a convention chair, an attendance list, their ballots, their delegate list, and their minutes. So each one has to have its own administrative sample. And then if you are the only one in your precinct, then you are the commission chair, the only one on the attendance list, and the keeper of the minutes. So it really can be just one person if necessary. There may be multiple precincts at your meeting place, but they must all complete this paperwork in order for us to be in compliance with the election code. Okay. Whoops. Just microphone, I keep bumping in. Okay. Now, so far as the ballots are concerned, there are some requirements listed here, but they'll be obtained from the state party, so you won't necessarily have to look at all of these details, and the president and governor are not, or the presidential race is not relevant this time. So we won't need any presidential nominating convention delegates. But all of our ballots have a none of the above option. That's in our bylaws, that any candidate applicant is running in the party convention against none of the above, so that, you know, if party members wanted to say, I'd rather have no one than that person, they have the ability to say that. So for the down ballot races, we talked about redacting the ballots for the non-applicable races, because people can only vote on those races that they'd be eligible to cast a vote for in November. So, as we mentioned, the state party will arrange to provide ballots, and so you don't have to worry so much about that next paragraph. And so, what basically happens in our nomination process is the voters are allowed to cast their ballots. The paperwork is done, and that is given to the county co-chair. And those precinct conventions name the delegates that are going to carry forward to the county convention. And so at the county convention, the results are certified. In other words, they've been cross-checked, everybody reviews, certify that the results are correct, and certify the races that are applicable in that county, okay? And also then the county convention elects delegates to the district and state convention. So then at the district level races are certified. At the state level, then the state, everything is rolled together, and the state level races are certified. But the results, because we have a binding precinct ballot, are basically apparent from the time of the precinct conventions. So all of that provides, the convention dates are all stipulated in the election code, But it, and so that's why we have to do it exactly that way. But it does provide a framework for us to start to build our collection process around. So you know that that's going to be going on. Regarding resolutions, this is sort of a sidebar. Members can pass them through this way as a way to pass them up to the state party for consideration, but it's not really germane to the nomination process. So what goes in the minutes? Not a whole lot of information other than who the functionaries were, what you did in terms of, which means, you know, voting on the county delegates, voting on the candidates, filling out the attendance list, and there's a minutes template that you can follow. And then what happens with all this paperwork? The precinct convention chair is responsible to ensure the convention materials are returned to the county chair. The minutes, attendance list, delegates list, and ballots need to be returned to your county chair no later than 3 days after the convention. And also a copy of the precinct attendees list must be sent to the state co-chairs no later than 3 days after the convention. And so obviously this is a, you know, this is where we know our starting point for how many people we would be approaching the ballot access run with. And there's also, in order to verify ballots, what we did in 2016, of course, we vote on paper ballots so that they can be recounted and so that they can be verified. And because we're spread out across the state, what we did in 2016 was we photographed the ballots so that they could also be cross-checked that way, and that's, you know, probably I imagine how we would continue. So let me get into just miscellaneous questions. Obviously, the responsibility for whether or not a voter voted elsewhere is the individual's responsibility, but we're trying to make sure that that doesn't happen. What is the primary purpose of the affiliation certificate? For people who forgot their voter registration cards to legally attest that they're registered to vote and did not vote in another convention or primary. And so there's that detail. And then it must be presented at subsequent conventions if that person's gonna continue on as a delegate through the process. So that's in a nutshell an outline of the precinct conventions and just a little bit more information. We have a schedule there of how many delegates based on county population the counties ultimately get to elect and send to the state convention. And let's see. And that's basically it. So obviously when I was preparing this, I started to print all the forms, and then it was just a lot of wasted paper and redundancy. But this outline goes through basically the whole process, and you can look and download each of these forms off the convention documents page. So in a nutshell, that is what we need to do to operate our precinct conventions. And with that, let's open it up to questions. Anybody have anything that needs clarifying, and what the heck are we supposed to do? Kevin?
Well, let's suppose you're in a large county and you have enough people to have two different locations. What do you do in the case of people from one precinct going to one location? I mean, first of all, is it possible to have these amalgamated precinct conventions in more than one place? Secondly, what do you do about the same precinct showing up, the voters in the same precinct showing up in different places?
Kat can field this.
Okay, so you can have every precinct in a different location. You just have to post it publicly. And they changed it so now you can post it on your website instead of going down to the county courthouse and posting it on the bulletin board that nobody looks at. So if you want to hold two conventions, two consolidated conventions, and like all these precincts are here, and all these precincts are here, that's fine. You just have to post it when you're required to post it. And then if somebody from this precinct shows up over here, they got to go over there. Just like you would if at a polling station. If you show up the wrong one, you got to go the right one.
Did I answer all the
set it up however you want, so that, like I said, every precinct can hold their own precinct convention in their own location. We just consolidate because it's usually like 5-10 people, and you know. Folder on Google Drive that is for 2016 conventions, you'll see all the counties that submitted data. I think there were like 8 counties or something that held conventions. And then I don't remember, were there like 30?
There were 65 ballots across the state of Texas cast in 2016 in 8 counties. So 22 precincts convened in Harris County, and a couple of those had a couple people in them, but by and large were single member precincts. So you see how far the gap is.
So what if somebody shows up to the precinct nominating convention and they don't have their voter registration card, they don't know their voter registration number?
Yeah, the computer.
Oh, they have to Google it.
The first thing to do is to look up on the Secretary of State's website, which is on that page for signature validity, is where you can look up every voter registrant, and it gives you their BUID. They do have to do, that's where the affiliation certificate comes into play, and they have, you have to give them one of those. This is required by law. This is not our, we didn't make this up. So you would just look up their, make sure that they get the right precinct information. I mean, that's why you want to look it up, right? But technically, they can come and vote and say, I don't have my voter registration card, I'm registered, and you give them a ballot. But, well, there's no such thing as provisional ballots in our world.
But if they don't have a photo ID and they don't have a voter registration card, it's considered a provisional ballot because they're still voting.
Yeah, technically, the voter ID stuff doesn't apply to our convention process from what I understand. But
it kind of does because you have to have,
we just need to verify that they're registered to vote and where they're registered to vote and give them the appropriate ballot.
How much did that
ballot? Date of birth and address.
I'm not sure about the individual counties, but in Denton County, for instance, okay, it's very easy. If someone shows up and says, I want to vote, you can look them up on the Denton County voter registration system and find out if they are in fact registered.
I thought I heard you say earlier that the rule was we're supposed to either look at their photo ID or look at their voter registration card. So what if they come and they say, I don't have any documentation, but here's my name and my address, and I swear I'm registered.
And date of birth.
Yeah, they just verbally tell us that stuff. Is that like against the law to let them participate?
Registered voter in the Secretary of State's database, and where whatever address they're listed as registered is where they get to vote. They, even if they moved, they still have to, that's how it is when you go to a normal polling place, right? You're registered at this other address, but you actually live over here, you still have to go over there to vote. So it would be the same thing. Back in the day before voter ID, people would show up without their voter registration card. We would look up their registration, give them the appropriate ballot, and end of story. Give them the affiliation certificate, etc. The voter ID bills, personally, I think that we, since we don't support the voter ID, I've never required somebody to show me their ID. If they have their voter card, I use that, and if they don't have their voter card, we look it up.
I would suggest that generally the voter registration card is king in that situation. On top of the fact that it gives an accurate address for which they are registered, it also can show whether they got the stamp for having voted in the primaries the previous week. Mm-hmm. Very important. Because if they got that, they're not qualified to participate in the convention.
Yeah, that's a really good point. So the point of the voter card, if you look on your voter card, which I could pull mine around if somebody wants to look at it, there's a vertical line right here that has... I think it says like primary or something like that.
Like primary, yeah.
Yeah, I voted in the whatever primary. So when you vote, they're supposed to stamp your card to show that you voted in the primary. Now, most people don't take their voter registration cards ever, and so they don't necessarily get stamped, and so they could technically go vote in the primary and then come vote in the conventions. And the caveat to that, or the additional thing to that, is that the Secretary of State's office does not produce a list of people who voted in the primaries fast enough and give it to us so that we can cross-check. But it is a felony to do it.
For them,
not for us. So if they vote in the primary and then come vote in our convention and they get caught, they've committed a crime. So, you know, it's... Right. But we could see, that's the other thing, like, you know, you want to run it like if it was a real election, right? So you know what the process you go through when you go to vote and you have to sign and there's like cross checking and everybody's checking that you're really who you are? That process should happen at the party convention. And you really need to grill people about the primary thing, because most people don't even know what a primary is, even if they vote in it. And this comes up with the petitioning, right? Like, you'll ask people, hey, did you vote in the primary? And they're like, I don't know. They're like, well, did you vote in March for the Democrats or the Republicans? And if they say yes, then they're out. If they say, I don't think so, they probably didn't. You know, but you have to, like, keep questioning people to get down to, like, whether or not they did, because some people actually do, and they don't even really understand there's a disconnect there, so.
Kevin?
Or Raquel, did you have your hand up?
I did.
Okay.
Just a real quick question. So if you are wanting to be a voting candidate, you are now a volunteer for precinct commission. But it kind of depends on your
You
career.
Could be.
I'm saying that this is an instrumental part, but this part does not go forward, neither does your candidate.
Correct.
Correct.
We spent a lot of time talking about this yesterday, the fact that for non-statewide candidates, the petition threshold of 500, it may be more within reach than going
okay.
on for party ballot access.
Okay.
But you're absolutely right. If somebody signs on to be a candidate for party ballot access, they have a vested interest in making sure this precinct convention process happens and the petition collection process happens.
Okay.
If somebody is going to be a statewide candidate and independent, they're going to have to carry that 1% burden themselves. So it's not too much to ask our candidates to get in and pull some weight here, because if they were going to be doing it outside of the party, they're going to have to pull some weight. It's a question of how serious they are.
Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. Kevin, Jerry, and Janice on staff.
Okay. Back to the precinct and the voter ID and stuff like that. This question may be very picky, okay? My voter registration card that I have, I've had for several years, and I don't think they send you out new ones.
They do.
Oh,
they
do.
They
do. You're supposed to go every 2 years.
Okay.
Every 2 years, you get a new card, they're a different color every time, and so that's how you can tell if it's a valid card based on the color.
Yeah, it's every 2 years in Dallas County, at least.
It's every county. Everybody gets a new one every 2 years.
Okay.
Unless you move, and then you get one more often. Gary?
Yes, have we gotten to the Worcester convention?
No.
Okay, because I understand about precinct county and state. I don't know what the district convention is.
We can answer that.
Yeah, so basically the...
Let me answer that question this way.
Okay.
The question goes to where are people actually nominated?
Okay.
And the answer is at county conventions, those people whose district is wholly within the county get nominated at the county convention.
Okay.
There are some districts that span multiple counties. Okay. And an example is Congressional District 24, okay. Which is in Dallas County and Denton County and in Tarrant County.
So that's a district.
Okay, so that in order to nominate someone for that particular district, there has to be a district convention. And the district convention has participants from each of the counties that are in that district. In the past, we've done this by telephone, and I really don't want to go into the detail of a lot specific of that. Okay. But that's what a district convention is. A district convention, there's one district convention for any district that is in more than one county.
Okay, then, just out of curiosity, then who is supposed to put that district convention together? Like, what county is supposed to do it if it's in three different counties? I mean, in this case.
Yeah. So I was just going to say, the precinct,